Pop star at 18.
Oh, yeah.
Grammy winner at 19.
Oh, my God, you guys.
Down and dirty diva at 22.
She wanted to show us, like, I'm growing up and you're going to have to take it or leave it.
But Christina Aguilera's wild ride to the top of the charts has not been easy. She was harassed as a kid.
That little ring of people who made our life so hellish.
Vilified as a Britney wannabe.
I just felt like I was in this bubble that I couldn't get out of.
And trashed by fashionistas.
They had to be like, Christina, dress like a whore.
Christina took the shots and fired right back.
Don't act like you know somebody or judge them, you know, based on maybe you've seen them for 20 seconds until you really live it, live it, live it.
For the next 2 hours, you'll really live it as Christina lives it. This is one electrifying performer who defies the odds and delivers the goods.
Uh-oh, here we go, here we go.
Christina Aguilera's life wasn't always something to sing about. She was a natural performer who worked hard to escape a painful childhood and turn herself into a superstar. But don't hate her because she's young, rich, and beautiful. At age 22, Christina's experience is a crash course in what it means to be talented, driven, and misunderstood.
Let me put these dances in shape.
My mom has always raised me to be like, as soon as you start taking it for granted or as soon as you, you know, get a big head about it, it can be taken away like that completely.
For Christina Aguilera, life was never a free ride. Born December 18th, 1980 in Staten Island, New York, Christina was the first child of Fausto and Shelley Aguilera. Fausto was an immigrant from Ecuador. Shelley worked as a translator.
When Christina was born, it changed my life completely. Oh, goodness. She was a tiny thing.
She may have been small, but Christina already had an ear for music and a voice to match.
Christina literally started singing when she was in diapers. She couldn't talk yet. And I would have her in a grocery cart in her little chair that you put infants in. And every time we passed under a speaker with music on it, she changed. She would perk up and listen.
Before Christina turned one, her father Fausto unloaded some shocking news. Us Weekly Entertainment editor Lori Majewski.
Faust surprised Shelley. He was like, I'm in the army. And for Shelley, that instantly meant that they were going to be moving.
I didn't know what to think. I was speechless. But I didn't have to say anything of my own life. And that, I thought, was a very, very major thing that I should have been consulted about.
So they came to live in San Antonio, and then as far away as Japan. This is really, really hard on a young woman who had a young child.
The move to Japan strained an already troubled marriage. Christina was Shelley's greatest joy and eased the pain of living so far away from home. The little girl regularly charmed her mom with some familiar show tunes.
When she was like 2 and 3, I had the soundtrack for The Sound of Music. And she loved that movie. She loved Julie Andrews when she went up on the mountain and sang The Hills Are Alive. And she would twirl around in the living room and she would sing that song.
I definitely connected with that movie. Not to be corny, but, you know, just free and alive in the hills and everything. And I didn't know, I just related to that.
She would throw the window open in Japan every day in her bedroom and sing every day.
It's really hard for a young girl who doesn't even speak the language there. She didn't have a lot of friends. So she would, her friends would be her dolls, and she would put on performances for her dolls. She would sing to them.
Meanwhile, her parents' marriage continued to deteriorate. The fights between Shelley and Fausto became raucous.
People say, why didn't she just get out of the situation? If it was really that bad, don't you just get up and leave and get divorced? It wasn't that easy. Remember that Shelley was a young mom. She had a young daughter. They did not have a lot of money. It's not like they could just charge up on a credit card and get a flight home.
I think that's, you know, my childhood and what, you know, I witnessed pretty much every day with the problems between my parents. I think that really was the reason I embraced music so much. It was just my way of just like trying to zone out of reality or what was really going on.
On June 6, 1986, Shelley gave birth to her second daughter, Rachel. That same year, the Army transferred Fausto from Japan to Fort Dix, New Jersey. By this time, Shelley and Fausto fought constantly, Mother and daughter lived in fear of Fausto's temper.
Christina would ask me every single day, here she is 6 years old only, whisper at night, can't we go live with Grandma yet? Why can't we go live with Grandma?
2 months after moving to Fort Dix, Shelley saved up enough money to escape her marriage. She packed up the girls and headed for her mother's home in Rochester, Pennsylvania.
Christina, I remember her in that car, looking back, you know, she was 6 years old. But Mommy, what if he comes home? He's gonna drive by. What if he takes a lunch break and drives by with his friends and recognizes our car?
She's amazing, enduring what she did and taking her kids out of that situation and putting food in our mouths and having to kind of do it alone and being the one parent in the household or whatever. I've learned so many lessons from that.
Shelley moved the girls in with her mother, Delcy Fiddler. Shelley knew Christina loved to sing, but it was Grandma who first recognized the six-year-old had a gift.
My mother noticed Christina's unusual talent first, because I was kind of still in survival mode and my, you know, world was spinning, but my mom said, wait a minute.
Christina's uncle, Jim Fiddler.
What's interesting was sitting at my mom's table, and she yelled upstairs to say, Christina, turn that radio off. And there wasn't a radio on.
My grandma really took a big interest in what I was doing, and she definitely was there to support and telling my mom, this could be something more than just, you know, something she loves to do.
She says, you know, she's going to be famous one day. Nobody sings like that at that age.
Christina's first grade teacher, Penny Householder.
We did a lot of singing in my classroom, and one day we sang Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star, and all of a sudden there was somebody singing louder than I was. I couldn't believe it. I found myself going, come here, you got to hear this little girl sing. And nobody could believe it, that this wonderful, wonderful voice would come out of such a tiny child.
It just was a way to release all the tension or bad energy, like, out from me and just, like, through my voice, you know? So it's a great feeling.
I wanted her to be in the talent show. It was Christina. I knew that she would just be a sensation up on the stage in front of everybody.
Shelley didn't mind, as long as Christina was happy.
Most of the parents in Rochester didn't realize that she had such a wonderful singing voice until the first talent show came about. For Christina, they closed the curtains and they put a big spotlight on her. She started to sing, and it was just, you could have heard a pin drop.
She was so good and so small that it was almost disconcerting and unsettling to certain people. This little girl could belt out a song like, you know, like a 20-year-old.
Six-year-old Christina was clearly born to perform.
I hadn't had any vocal lessons or anything like that. I just kind of went up there and did my thing. And, you know, my grandma taught me how to work the stage.
After the first year, when she was so sensational, she did it again in second grade, third grade.
I had, gee whiz, every mother under the sun coming up to me, you have to enroll her in Star Search. Send an audition tape into Star Search.
Finally, Shelley took a chance and sent Christina's audition tape to the producers of the TV show. Star Search talent scouts called her back in less than a week.
When I made it, it was just like, oh my God.
At that point, she was like 8 years old. That's when the mother stopped talking to me.
Coming up.
I would actually time it so that she would go right into class so nobody could jump her.
And later, Dueling Divas.
It was that whole high school mentality of pitting the good girl against the bad girl.
Please give an international welcome to Christina Aguilera.
My first actual national television performance was like at a Star Search when I was 8 years old.
Long before American Idol topped the TV ratings, there was Star Search. The series gave aspiring performers the chance to appear on television and compete for a $100,000 grand prize.
It would be a ritual. You know, me and my mom, my grandma, we would watch it every Saturday when it was on.
On March 15th, 1990, Christina made her national television debut on the popular syndicated talent show.
I couldn't see the audience because at that age I actually wore these little glasses. I didn't want to wear them on stage.
And here's just this little teeny thing. And she was wearing my concert blouse with a belt on it, with this big gaudy belt. But I let her wear it because she loved it.
I went out there and I just, you know, I just did what I always, you know, did before and got into it. And again, it was just something that always just came naturally.
First, the tiebreaker. Junior vocalists, either Christopher Eason or Christina Aguilera. Let's see who the winner is. Champion once again, Christopher Eason.
I was so sad. I was so upset when I lost at 8 years old. It was my first big upsetting moment of my life.
Christina's first rejection was played out on national television, but it taught her a big show business lesson.
I made her just buck up and go congratulate him, because I figured, honey, you enjoy doing this, but you got to remember, if you're going to do the kind of shows where there's a winner and a loser, you have to be a good loser, too. It comes with this territory. She was so upset with me.
At the end of the show, I was through tears going, congratulations, I'm really happy for you. You know, it was the right thing to do. My mom raised me well.
She did lose on Star Search, but to the people back home in Pennsylvania, this was a really big deal. I mean, Christina was on TV. She was on national television.
The teacher had this giant banner printed out, congratulations, and all balloons. And that was like a class assignment where the teacher had all the kids give her congratulations. And really sweet things were written on it.
But the celebration was short-lived. Christina's star turn on Star Search suddenly turned ugly.
So when Christina came home, the very same people that had encouraged Shelly, they were suddenly really cold and very jealous.
Despite the pettiness, Christina's powerhouse pipes stopped people in their tracks. A popular Pittsburgh talk show host couldn't help but notice.
Good morning, I'm Christina Aguilera. And 6:30, and time to wake up with Larry Richard.
Larry Richard, I love, he's so sweet. We had a very early morning show, like 6:30 in the morning. And for any singer trying to sing at 6 or 6:30 in the morning is bad enough, let alone like a 9-year-old.
A rising star, her name is Christina Aguilera on the Wake Up Show. Ladies and gentlemen, Christina.
Well, she was wearing a little dress, and she was so sweet and so cute. And her mom was a wonderful Shelly, and they both came to the studio, and I was trying to put her at ease and make her feel comfortable, because I didn't want her to get on the air live and, you know, freeze up.
On a Sunday kind of love, a love to last. Saturday night.
Little did I know, once she started singing, completely metamorphosized into somebody else, and we were all shocked. You know, like, wow, look at this kid.
Outstanding, outstanding. Thank you so much. She's so energetic.
Christina's passion for singing led to other local gigs, including the Jude Pohl Talent Showcase. The charity event raised money for the homeless in Pittsburgh and gave amateurs a platform to perform.
Christina's mom called us when she heard about the talent showcase and sent us a videotape of Christina. It took about 5 seconds to decide that we wanted her.
I'd like to introduce Miss Christina Aguilera.
She was very shy. She would show up and come and just sit over by herself until it came time to sing, and then she would get up. And it was almost as if the microphone was a magic wand. And the second that she grabbed the microphone in her hand, she became a star. Christina asked if she could come the next year and be in the contest as a contestant, like as if we would say no. And, of course, she won, and she kept coming back month after month and went all the way. No one could beat her.
As time went by, when people would find out they were up against Christina, they wouldn't show up.
Miss Christina Aguilera. And I'm sorry that we have to end the show abruptly, but nobody else wants to come out now. Nobody wants to follow her.
Singing was a huge outlet for me at a really early age. It was something that I could completely become in my own element, in my own world, and my thing, my release, my everything.
Honing her skills on talent shows and at block parties, Christina caught the attention of another Pittsburgh area mover and shaker.
Walt Maddox, he is like part of the family at this point. He was a judge on the Jude Pohl Talent Showcase. He used to be part of the Marcells.
The Marcells were a 1960s doo-wop group, best known for their hit singles Blue Moon and Heartache.
Walt is probably
As far as an icon in Pittsburgh music, he's been a living legend for a long time.
Well, I'd been working a lot with kids, and after I saw her, then I went and talked to Shelley and said, I do a lot of programs with kids. Would you have any objection to letting me add Christina to the performances?
He particularly saw the talent in her and took her under his wing.
Walt gave Christina the freedom to perform the kind of music she loved to sing.
I also really had a love for the blues, and getting into some of those things, and you know, the Billie Holidays, and even taking, you know, B.B. King.
She came to me one day and said, I'd like to add a song to my repertoire. And I said, okay, what would you like to do? And she said, I'd like to sing The Thrill Is Gone. And I thought, where do you know about The Thrill Is Gone?
Every time she did a little block party or something, like five people would come up and want her for their wedding or their political banquet. And here's this little child being hired as the entertainment for these places.
Walt Maddox continued to keep his young protege in the public eye. Walt insisted Christina perform at one of Pittsburgh's most celebrated events.
The Dapper Dan dinner in Pittsburgh is the biggest sports banquet of the year. It's the who's who of not only the sporting world, but also the people who spend the money to come to the dinner to support the Dapper Dan charities.
While we were there, someone from the Penguins said, we want you to do the national anthem.
The little girl with the big voice soon made headlines.
Christina ended up in the paper quite a bit.
But all that attention didn't sit well with Christina's classmates.
It was a small town celebrity kind of thing, you know. It's just like, got to the point where I kind of didn't even want to talk about what I was doing publicly or around the town, just because when I did, I would get such, you know, attitude from my peers.
I used to tell her, honey, you ask me why this is happening to you. Why do these people hate you? They don't even know you. I don't know. All I can think of is that maybe God's preparing you. Maybe this is a blessing. You know, it hurts, but sometimes blessings hurt, because what happens is the strength that you get when you come out of the other side, on the other side of the pain, prepares you for really big things.
Once again, Christina found comfort in her music.
Whenever I would watch concerts, like on TV, and I would see, you know, the audience and how they would just, you know, just their roar and their just love for this person up on stage and their appreciation for their work, and it was just like, wow, you know, like that, you know, made me feel alive inside. I knew this was what I was meant to do.
She never seemed to really want to be anything other than an entertainer. It never occurred to her.
And how long have you been singing?
Oh, since I was in diapers. I love to sing.
10-year-old Christina got another chance to show her stuff. The folks at Disney needed some fresh faces for a 90s version of a classic 50s TV series.
My mom ran across this tiny, tiny little article in the newspaper about an open audition, or a cattle call, so to speak, for the Mickey Mouse Club. Anybody could come, but you had to sing, dance, and act. And you had to come prepared. There were two men, Matt Casella and his assistant Cortez. Oh my gosh, there was like 400 people there.
I'll never forget this, because Christina was in a group of 25, and I just kept looking over and staring at this little girl. I mean, she was so tiny. She had a little resume her mom had written out with a pen. She'd written out, you know, she had sung the national anthem. I'm like, this kid sang the national anthem.
They didn't allow the parents inside, because they really meant business. They wanted to see that the kids weren't being coached or signaled by their parents.
She starts singing Vision of Love, 25 people in a line, no parents in the room, just me. And she sang the entire song and hit every note, riffed, belted, did everything. And when it was over, there was like stunned silence in the room. And then all the kids just started applauding and clapping and going nuts.
Christina nailed round one of the audition. Next came a one-on-one meeting with Matt.
She had a little case of all of her cassettes.
Oh my gosh, I forgot about that suitcase. Yeah, this brown little suitcase that we carried around that just had, you know, the standard stuff people actually wanted to hear.
She opened it up and she said, what do you want to hear? And I said, what do you got? And literally, I'm not kidding you, she had about 50 songs she had memorized.
Christina wowed Casella, but there was one little problem.
She was underage, and we didn't know it because they didn't specify the age limits.
The folks at Disney didn't know what I had gone through and what I had seen. I went back and really, really, really pushed to put her on the show that year. I just couldn't do it because of the rules. I guess there's strict rules with child labor laws.
Showbiz, Christina learned, wasn't just about talent. And in 1991, the 10-year-old faced another fact of life. Her mom began seeing paramedic Jim Kearns.
When I first began dating, you know, it was kind of fun. Oh, cool, mom's dating. Then when I met Jim and little by little things started getting serious, my children became She-Ra out there trying to be a defender of the universe. It was hard because of their background.
Christina may have played it tough at home, but her talent and charisma were about to get her run out of town.
When did this voice, this big voice, come from this little girl? When did this start, Christina?
Oh, ever since I was a baby. I love to sing.
By 1992, 11-year-old Christina Aguilera was a singing sensation in her hometown of Pittsburgh. She was also a sixth-grade pariah. The terrible jealousy Christina felt from her classmates took a vicious turn.
There was a girl who kind of had her little posse or whatever that was grades older than me, and they like threatened to, you know, slash my mom's tires and the whole thing. It was just, you know, and it really hurt my mom.
I remember that when she was still in Rochester, we had to watch that group of girls because they would go behind stage when it was Christina's turn and actually try to unplug amps.
It's just that thing that just goes to show you, it's like once you get somewhere, there's always going to be people that just want to knock you down just to get at you, you know, just to make you feel like, oh, you're not that special.
She began to have nightmares, and it was just getting scary for me. I mean, she'd be late at class every day because I would time just when the bell rang, because she had threats coming out the ears about from this group of girls. I would actually time it so that she would go right into class so nobody could jump her.
By late fall, Christina and her mother were fed up with the harassment.
I still call it the mini mafia. That little ring of people who made our life so hellish that she had nightmares that we had to actually leave my hometown where I was born and raised.
Shelley packed up the girls and moved to Wexford, Pennsylvania to be with her boyfriend, Jim Kearns.
As soon as we got to Wexford area, she got the call from the Mickey Mouse Club.
Said, Shelley, I'm not going to Pittsburgh, I'm going to Cincinnati. Get in the car if you can and drive Christina over here and let me get her on tape and audition her again. And I can pretty much guarantee you she'll get on the show.
So of course, we piled in the car, and by that time I was living with Jim. And we just took off.
I brought the tapes back, showed up to everyone at Disney, everyone was in full agreement, she needs to go to the camp. The Mickey Mouse Club camp was a 3-day process where the executives at Disney interviewed the parents as the kids were being sort of worked with and taught songs and dance routines.
It was actually really, really great at that time because for the first time in my life, I was kind of thrown in with a bunch of kids that, oh my God, they like doing the same things that I like to do.
Nikki Deloach was one of the 24 kids at the casting camp.
Initially, she was shy, and she had glasses. She just sat and she would eat lunch by herself, and then she would sing. And all of a sudden, when she would open her mouth to sing, it was like, where is this coming from?
Out of 10,000 kids, 7 of them got on the show.
Including Nikki, Christina and 2 other young guns were also poised for the big time. Justin Timberlake and Britney Spears. Then in the spring of 1993, Shelley, Rachel, and 12-year-old Christina moved to Orlando, Florida for the 6th season of the Mickey Mouse Club. With a cast of 18 kids, the 7 freshman Mouseketeers quickly bonded.
Britney, Christina, and I shared a dressing room together. Britney and Christina were very close right off the bat. They were pretty much about the same age, and I was kind of like the big sister.
The experience we both had on the television show at such a young age, I think it just, you know, there was nothing that was bad about it. I mean, we all were there and we all loved what we were doing.
It was great just to be in with a bunch of kids that just loved doing what I did. And there was no, like, animosity towards each other. It's like we were all in there together. We were like a team in a way.
We were more concerned with how could we get a free milkshake. In the
theme
park.
Well, that's what Justin was thinking about.
Yeah.
No,
well, that's not the only thing I was thinking about.
Each Mouseketeer played a specific role. Britney and Nikki were dancers. Christina, with her powerhouse voice, was a featured singer.
When Christina started, like, coming out as a person and showing her personality, the first thing that would come to mind is she's just a little diva. She had that attitude, in her walk, the way she performed, the way she sang. It was just, you know, it was this confidence.
However, it was during Christina's second season on the Mickey Mouse Club when she really started to shine.
Because I'm such a fan of singers and people who can, you know, just down and out sing. That was the one thing that always stood out for me about Christina. You know, I just remember when I was 12, I was like, that voice is going to be a big voice one day.
We were performing in front of a live audience. That's when it seemed like she really started to fall into her place as a performer. And it was really great to watch.
But the good times didn't last. In 1994, after seven seasons, the Mickey Mouse Club was canceled. Suddenly, Christina was out of a job.
I think we were all a little devastated. It was like, it was sad, you know.
Good heavens. I mean, Christina and Brittany would just clang and cry.
This was her, the beginning of everything for her. When they told us it was over, it was kind of like, well, what am I going to do now? Do I have to go back home? Do I have to go back to all of that?
In November 1994, Christina returned to Wexford, Pennsylvania as a full-time student at Marshall Middle School. Different town, different school, same old problem. Jealous classmates. Cheryl Gergiolo was one of Christina's few friends.
What I did see in middle school were children saying some things that were very nice about her, mainly thinking that she's stuck up or just because she's singing that she's better than everyone, when in fact she was just trying to be herself.
By 1995, 14-year-old Christina Aguilera felt a little lost. In May, her mother married paramedic Jim Kearns, bringing a sense of stability to the family. One year later, Shelley gave birth to a son, Michael Kearns. Meanwhile, Christina remained very much the outsider at school.
If they would be like, well, you know, sing for us, and I'd be like, okay, because I didn't want to deal with the opposite end, they'd be like, oh, well, look, she's showing off again. You know, it was just like a double-edged sword. Like, I couldn't win either way.
Shelley did not want to see Christina bullied again. She began homeschooling her 15-year-old daughter.
That is when things really started taking off with her music, and that is when Christina really became focused.
What Christina wanted more than anything else was to return to the spotlight. She recorded a demo which included the song Just Be Free, but nothing happened.
I made this cake for her because I felt so bad. And she was watching, I think, Mariah accepting the award or something, and she started to cry. Because she wanted this so bad. I'm going to get emotional over this. I'm surprised. She wanted this so bad. And, you know, I said, honey, I don't know. I can't explain why I know this deep inside, but I know you're going to make it.
We decided it was time to look for management and representation out of New York, and so that was the next step because I wanted to get a record deal.
In 1997, 16-year-old Christina signed with manager Steve Kurtz. Kurtz didn't waste any time booking Aguilera.
A lot of things happened rather quickly right in the beginning. She had the chance to work with a pop star that was one of the top pop stars in Japan. And his name is Keizo Nakanishi, sweetest man. We ended up flying over to Japan so that she could record with him. And ended up going back later, by the way, to be part of his tour.
Christina returned from the tour and immediately began work on a new demo with the producer-songwriter team of Rob Hoffman and Heather Hawley.
First time I met her, I spoke to her on the phone. And we just kind of were checking each other out and seeing if we would all be able to work together.
We talked about the need for a big ballad to showcase her voice. And Heather said,
well, I am working on this song called Obvious. We'll put it together and put it on a tape and send it to you. And she said, no, I want to hear it right now.
And we had this like junky electric piano in the corner, and Heather starts playing it, and I held the phone up to her, and immediately, like by the time she got to the first chorus, Christina's like, that's it, that's the song I want, you know, I want to sing that one.
She came from Pittsburgh to LA to record the demo. We recorded 5 songs in 5 days, very fast paced for any singer, especially a young singer like that.
In 1997, another ex-Mouseketeer, Britney Spears, was about to turn the music world upside down.
The week we were doing the demo, she got a phone call that Britney had gotten a deal with Jive Records. So there was definitely this urgency, like, all right, I'm going to do this.
Christina's demo tape caught the attention of RCA music executive Ron Fair.
I got the original demos and listened through them, and the first couple songs I thought were, you know, they were average, not remarkable. But the the last song on the tape was a song called Obvious. And in it was a glorious section of singing where her tone soared.
Ron offered Christina a development deal. But before the ink was dry on the contract, fate stepped in.
I got a call from Chris Montan, who was the head of music for Walt Disney Pictures, Disney Studios.
We were casting the song Reflection, which was the big ballad in Milan.
The animated film was one of the big summer releases for the studio.
We needed a singer that had tremendous range. It needed somebody that really, really could, had a big expressive singing voice.
And inside of Reflection, there's an interval in the chorus that is exactly the same melodic structure as the interval in the song Obvious. It jarred me, like a little bell went off in my head.
And Ron said, Christina, she hasn't recorded yet or anything, and I think we're still working out what kind of direction she's gonna take. But she's got an incredible voice, and she may be what you're looking for.
And Ron definitely gave us a call and asked if I could hit the high E above middle C.
And she's like, Mom, can I hit this note? You know, and I said, I don't know. Like, probably. I mean, let's try it on the piano.
So I go in the bathroom. The teeny little sounding, the bathroom's like this small in my house. And this little cheesy little dinky tape recorder. And I'm singing to the song or whatever, and I hit the note. We send it in. They offer to fly me out.
Winter of 1998. Christina Aguilera was about to get her big break. Disney executives tapped a talented 17-year-old to sing the theme song for the animated film Mulan. But did Christina have the chops to pull it off? Composer and producer Matthew Wilder.
We needed a voice that was able to sing the scale on the piano that spanned at least two octaves.
Christina flew to Los Angeles to record Reflection.
It's hard for someone just to sing off the cuff live for somebody in a studio like that. It's got to be a little nerve-wracking for the person. But she just kind of let it go, and we were making eye contact within about three or four lines, because I've known Matt for years, and we knew that she was going to be perfect.
Look at me, you may think you see who I really am, but you'll never know me.
And we all unanimously jumped up and said, that's it, you know, now let's get busy in making this record.
They were like, okay, you got the job. And I ended up singing on the Mulan soundtrack. And, you know, in the same week, I was signing that contract to be a part of, and also being signed to RCA with Ron Fair. So it was kind of just a crazy week.
This was the high dive into the big pool of her career. It all hinged on the success of this moment. So this was a big neon sign for Christina. This was so important for her.
This song is very rangy, meaning it's got a lot of high notes, and high notes that you have to sustain, which are not easy for singers. And she really hadn't been in the recording studio very much at all.
We had maybe a two-hour window to get the best of her voice before her voice started giving out. And what became evident to all of us on the production team at that point was that she was going to need a little bit of help.
Wilder brought in a vocal coach to teach Christina better breath control. She was going to need all the help she could get.
Once the record was released, Christina was put upon to join us at these press junkets and perform the song in front of hundreds, if not thousands of people, and this little girl gets up and she had to stand up and sell the moment. The pressure never goes away. It only builds. They only just keep adding layers of pressure.
Reflection received Golden Globe and Academy Award nominations. But the song didn't become the big hit Disney execs hoped for. Christina still had to prove herself. By August 1998, the teen pop craze gained momentum. Determined to be part of the scene, Christina flew back to Los Angeles to record her first album.
We didn't say, okay, let's make a teen pop album. We wanted to make an album that would appeal to people like her, her age, young girls, but also an album that would, one, grab everybody's attention, two, keep them moving on the dance floor, three, show her incredible voice.
To reach those goals, Ron paired Christina with music industry veterans Diane Warren and Guy Roche. Roche worked with many pop divas, including Celine Dion, Cher, and Brandy.
From the first day I met her, it always felt like she was an old soul, like she knew exactly where she was going, what she was doing, and what she wanted.
What Christina wanted was control.
Making the record was very confining to me because I wasn't allowed to really sing the way I wanted to.
Ron Fair, who is really her artistic confidant, saw it a certain way, and she disagreed a bit.
When she was younger, she couldn't just sit down and say, guys, I'm not really feeling that. I think I'd rather do this. I think she felt pushed around because she's a kid in an adult world.
I was just so freaking happy to have a record deal. It was just like, God, you know, and, I didn't want to lose the record deal or anything.
She had her way with a couple of lines here and there, and that were actually great lines because it gave her more character than, you know, other singers, and so I'm glad she fought for it.
The pressure was on. Christina felt compelled to deliver a hit.
She was recording with several different producers. One day she'd have to be in Studio City for something, the next day Hollywood at another studio. She was getting shuttled around. She didn't drive at the time.
I was away from my family. I had to come out here on my own, and I was living out of a hotel by myself. You know, it was tough.
Occasionally we get these late night calls of, you know, what do? I'm here alone.
In January 1999, Christina completed the final touches on her CD. Meanwhile, Britney Spears' album Baby One More Time went double platinum. The race to be crowned pop princess was on.
Britney was the first one on the scene. She made a huge splash. She was the first person to do this in more than a decade.
Well, anytime you're both diving in the pool and it's a race to get to the end, you're going to look, oh, damn, I better catch up. Someone's ahead of me.
That really put a lot of pressure on Christina and Christina's record company, because would the second one out have as big of an impact as the first?
Christina did ask me, do you like this? And I mean, nothing against Britney, but I said, you have nothing to do with Britney. You're totally different. You know, she was really worried about the competition with Britney.
As RCA geared up to release Christina Aguilera's first CD, Britney Spears appeared on the April 15th cover of Rolling Stone, posing as a seductive yet virginal vamp. RCA wanted to generate a similar buzz for Christina, based on her voice, not her look.
We had done a series of very high-level, kind of manicured showcases where high-level talent bookers, agents, record people, radio people would come into a hotel, and Christina sang, with a pianist, three songs.
The main song I remember is At Last. She had a very powerful rendition of it. Blew everybody away in the audience, you know, the business people.
So at that moment in time, those people who were like the tastemakers and the string pullers in the business heard her at her essence. That incredible voice with one instrument, no banging drums, and that's how we showed her to the industry.
She was incredible, and everybody left that showcase thinking she's the next big thing.
Still, RCA's decision to release Genie in a Bottle as the first single rubbed Christina the wrong way.
I wasn't too happy about Genie being the first single, to be honest. I wanted something that I could kind of, you know, just sing a little more on, you know.
I know Christina probably would have, if she could turn the clock back, wanted to put out the big ballad first, where she really showed what she could do. But that wouldn't have made sense. We needed Genie in a Bottle to go first to get everybody's attention.
In June 1999, RCA gave the rest of America a sneak peek at its budding star. The company arranged for Christina to perform Genie in a Bottle at the first Teen Choice Awards. The network special was Christina's first TV appearance since the Mickey Mouse Club 5 years earlier.
I was so nervous, but it was my first time singing Genie in a Bottle live on television.
I sat next to Jennifer Love Hewitt and behind Sarah Michelle Gellar, and when that song went over and when Christina took her bow, they turned around and they looked at each other like, who is this girl?
The buzz on Christina quickly spread across the country. But before Genie in a Bottle was officially released, Christina wanted to enjoy life as a normal teenager. Like millions of other young girls, Christina longed to attend a high school prom. Since she was homeschooled, Christina tagged along to a friend's big night.
She was really excited about it, and when she got there, she was, they actually played Genie in a Bottle, and she was shocked because the whole dance floor cleared.
It was almost like a slap in the face, I think, to Christina. And she was very excited. This was something she wanted to show off.
It sent a signal to her that she didn't belong there. Her date was scorned for bringing her. And it was a shocking experience because Christina didn't deserve it.
9 days after her prom disaster, Christina had the last laugh. On June 22, 1999, RCA released Genie in a Bottle. The song was a smash hit.
From zero to number one in 5 weeks. That's like ridiculous. That tells you we made the right choice.
It was like the height of the teen pop phenomenon craze. Genie in a Bottle fit right into that whole pop sound that they were going for.
The song appealed to more than just teeny boppers. Hip-hop diva Lil' Kim.
I love that song, Genie in a Bottle. After that, I was like, I know that girl is going to go a long way.
See your name for the number one spot on Billboard, it was like, God, you know, it was crazy. You know, just Genie exploded, and all of a sudden I'm on this crazy roller coaster ride.
Coming up, fame bites.
They want to read the dirt. They want to read the garbage. They want to hear about, you know, rivalry.
By the summer of 1999, 18-year-old Christina Aguilera's first single, Genie in a Bottle, was a number one hit. But Genie's magic didn't come from just the driving dance beat. The song's sexual innuendo offended some listeners.
People started realizing she was singing, I want you to rub me the right way. At first, I think people were really shocked.
Christina's image as a teen tart only fueled the public's fascination. On August 24th, 1999, her album Christina Aguilera exploded onto the Billboard charts.
When Christina's debut album actually debuted at number one, beating Puff Daddy, she was floored. Her head was spinning.
Everybody thought that the Puff Daddy album was going to be number one. We beat it. It was an unprecedented, gigantic moment in all of our careers. The label, myself, and Christina. First week, number one album.
Christina was thrilled, but the newest pop sensation was hardly prepared for what happened next. Christina appeared on the MTV show Total Request Live. Regular host Carson Daly was on vacation. Christina left him a message that said, "Sorry I missed you." The next morning, the little note became big news. USA Today ran a story suggesting Christina was trying to break up Daly's relationship with Jennifer Love Hewitt.
Christina's not that kind of a girl. Christina and Carson were friends, and I remember her talking about Carson, but Christina is not the type of person to inflict something like that on someone.
The gossip mill kept churning. Rumors spread of a bitter rivalry between Christina and Britney Spears. Christina's friend Steve Salito.
They were both blonde. They had both been on the Musketeers. So all these, you know, immediate comparisons are there, right there. And the press loves that.
It's a business. They want their magazine sold. And people don't want to read about, you know, somebody they perceived having a perfect life. They want to read the dirt. They want to read the garbage. They want to hear about, you know, rivalries.
Wardrobe stylist and friend Trish Somerville.
I think, again, it was that whole high school mentality of pitting the good girl against the bad girl.
Britney is bubbly and happy, and I think it's the product of her happy childhood and having tons of friends.
And Christina's much more shy, and I think as a lot of times maybe that comes across as being aloof.
And me and Britney have laughed many times about it together, like, so stupid, you know? It's just dumb.
That's exactly what Lil' Kim thought.
When I first met Christina Aguilera, this is the 1999 MTV Awards, where I had on the purple pasty with the purple wig. She walked up to me by herself. She's this little petite girl. And she goes, "You're Lil' Kim, right? Oh my gosh, I love you." She gave me so much props, and I just felt the warmness from her. I'm like, dang, you know? She was really, really nice. Her attitude was all right, you know? And she was like, "I would love to work with you one day."
Christina would later get her wish. But in December 1999, she received an honor most artists only dream about. Christina was asked to perform in a TV special. Christmas at the White House. President Bill Clinton was the guest of honor. It was a night her mom would never forget.
That's a very proud moment for me. She went out on the stage alone, and she sang with B.B. King. Now, that's a very special thing, because when she was little, she would ask, Mommy, put on the fun songs, and it was B.B. King. And here she is singing the same song, and you know, as a mom, I flash back to then.
On December 18th, 1999, Christina celebrated her 19th birthday. 10 days later, her new single, What a Girl Wants, hit record stores. The song became Christina's second single to make the top 20 in 3 months. A whirlwind tour to promote her album soon followed. Everybody, it seemed, wanted a piece of Christina Aguilera.
Her album is a runaway giganto smash like hers that took over the world. Your schedule is havoc. Everybody from every corner of the universe wants time. They want to interview you for every country. Every single magazine wants their own photo shoot. Then there's radio dates, and there's promotion for radio, then there's television shows, and the television specials, and there's touring, and there's more interviews, and there's more photo shoots. It's nuts.
Christina gave all she had every night, to the delight of her growing legion of fans. But Christina also took time out to hang with pals like Carson Daly. Again, tabloid reporters pounced.
Carson Daly had invited Christina during Super Bowl weekend to come out with him to a strip club, and she went. And uh-oh, next thing you know, Christina, her life is spinning out of control. Christina, you know, she's a young woman. She wanted to check out a strip club. Chill. It's okay.
In just 6 months, Christina's album raked in more than $7 million. But an even bigger triumph was still to come. The date, February 23rd, 2000. The event, the 1999 Grammy Awards.
We had a conversation that day, and she was real freaked out about the whole thing, and I told her, you know, write a speech, you gotta be ready. And she said, I don't want to jinx it.
Some of the hottest names in music were up for the Best New Artist. They included Macy Gray, Kid Rock, Britney Spears, and Christina Aguilera.
I knew, I had a real feeling that Christina was going to win. Britney, who has all the appeal in the world and is an incredible entertainer, isn't the great singer that Christina is.
And the Best New Artist is...
Oh, come on.
Christina Aguilera!
That was probably the biggest shock of my entire life, ever. I totally didn't expect to win at all. My manager almost had to push me out of my seat because I was just frozen in utter shock.
Wish my mom could be there.
I couldn't be there because I was sick. I knew I was there to her because, I mean, I'm watching her go up to accept the Grammy, her lifelong dream. And before she even gets on the stage, she stops and she looks in the camera. She goes, Mommy. And I just fell apart.
I go up there and make the dumbest speech off the top of my head and forgot names, of course, but... Yeah, it was an amazing moment.
But Christina did not forget two very important people in her life.
Thank you so much. My mom, my dad,
I remember her calling me, and she was on the phone, and she said, you don't think they thought I meant daddy. Daddy is Fausto. Dad is Jim, you know, so.
Jim Kearns got the message. But the glow from Christina's Grammy win faded fast. In April 2000, she once again fought off tabloid rumors. The latest gossip came from singer Eminem. In his hit single, The Real Slim Shady, the rapper insinuated that Christina hooked up with rocker Fred Durst of Limp Bizkit and Carson Daly. The lyrics were way over the top.
She said, you know, yeah, I'm hurt because it's not true. But, you know, I still respect him as an artist.
The bigger you get, I guess, the more people want to gossip and say untrue things about you, and they want to pull negative things out of nowhere. And it's just, you know, sometimes it makes you want to laugh, and sometimes it makes you want to cry. I just have to roll with it, and hopefully my true fans will stick behind me.
Coming up, size does matter.
They were just losing pounds. Like, Christina was down to, like, a negative zero.
And later, who can a diva trust?
And those are the people that were my shoulder to cry on.
On July 31st, 2000, Christina Aguilera headlined her first major U.S. concert tour. 35 cities in just 11 weeks. Destiny's Child was the opening act. The itinerary was grueling. But Christina thrived on connecting with her fans.
Oh, I love being on the road. I mean, the live performance and being on stage is
the most rewarding thing about doing what I do. There's so much energy that goes into live performing, but it can be very stressful and a lot of hard work.
The schedule was 24/7. She never had downtime on tour. She just didn't. She was worked every single day. She never lip-synced.
Between concert dates, interviews, and personal appearances, Christina managed to record a Christmas CD and a Spanish version of her self-titled debut album. Rudy Perez produced Mi Reflejo, Reflection.
Her schedule was just crazy. I mean, she would be here for 3 days and then leave. I wouldn't see her for another 2 months, and then she would show up for 5 days. She was exhausted from work.
With her and all the dancers were monthly. We would have to either send out new clothes or have their clothes altered because they were doing so many shows and working so hard and dancing so hard, no one could keep any weight on.
The physical demands of the show taxed Christina's tiny frame.
They were getting them like protein shakes and protein drinks, and they were just losing pounds. Like, Christina was down to like a negative zero.
Rumors began to circulate that Christina suffered from a serious eating disorder.
During that time when she would hear things about she was anorexic, I think that really got to her and hurt her feelings because here she was trying to gain weight.
In August 2000, Christina found refuge from the relentless gossip and exhausting schedule. She fell in love with 23-year-old George Santos, one of the dancers in her show.
Oh, George is so sweet. He's Latin, so he's very romantic. He was very supportive of her.
I think George was the first person that she could actually confide in, that she can trust, that was her best friend as well as boyfriend.
That same month, Christina's single Come On Over was released. The video sizzled. With her barely there hip huggers and suggestive dance moves, Christina raised the bar for teen pop sexuality.
At the height of the teen pop phenomenon phase thing of being cookie cutter and clean cut and playing it safe so much, which an image that really wasn't me.
And you have to remember, at the time, Britney was getting sexier and sexier with every video, and she was growing and developing, and Christina was too.
A lot of blonde hair going on out there too. I'm just like, wow. That's why, you know, I'm kind of looking to change my look a little bit.
Christina had more surprises in store for fans and critics. In September 2000, she sang a duet with Fred Durst of Limp Bizkit.
And it was a shock because so many rumors had gone down that they had dated, that he was mad at her. It actually turned his fans against him. And the next thing you know, it's like, oh, Fred Durst, why'd you perform with Christina? You know, you sold out.
Christina was forced to fight the sellout label herself. When her Spanish language album, Mi Reflejo, was released that same month, some critics accused Christina of trying to cash in on the Latin music craze.
The fact that she's American, she doesn't speak Spanish, I know what everybody's thinking. But look, she wants to connect with her roots. She's doing it really out of true love for Latin music.
Christina's fans responded with what counted most, cash. Mi Reflejo debuted numero uno on the Latin charts, selling 442,000 copies in the U.S. alone.
I think it was the perfect timing. The whole Latin explosion was taking off, you know, Ricky Martin, Mark Anthony, all these guys were just exploding, and Christina, you know, Christina touched on the bicultural kids.
While Christina's Latin album generated plenty of heat, her fashion sense got the cold shoulder. On September 18th, Christina made People Magazine's worst dressed list, while Britney Spears made the best dressed.
Being an artist that is not afraid to push more limits with either my look or my sound or my music, being out in the open out there is going to be judged more, and it's going to be criticized more for not playing it so straight-laced.
I think what bothers her is the cattiness and the negativity. Constructive criticism is great, but when it comes from a really malicious, ill-spirited manner, that can hurt anyone's feelings.
In October 2000, Christina made some major changes in her life. Boyfriend George Santos moved into her L.A. home. She severed ties with longtime manager Steve Kurtz.
She had outgrown that manager. That's the way Christina felt about it. And Steve, you know, of course he was hurt.
I was being overworked. I wasn't being looked after at all. You know, it was like my needs were not their interests. I was working, you know, my ass off for I don't know how long, and this was the first time I got to breathe.
I think we all knew that eventually she was going to need a management team to take her into superstardom.
In late 2000, Christina signed with legendary music manager Irving Azoff. Azoff's client list included Patti LaBelle, the Eagles, and the Backstreet Boys.
So Irving came in and basically cleaned house. He fixed everything that had been done wrong previously, immediately got the ball moving in the right direction.
Having Irving come in there and take the upper hand and go, no, she needs time, you know, to explore her thoughts and feelings, live a normal life for a second.
Xtina used the time for some serious soul searching about her next album.
I just felt like I was in this bubble that I couldn't get out of, you know, and this image that everyone had of me that after a while, just I was growing out of it. It really wasn't me, you know, I felt really uncomfortable in my own skin, and I started writing lyrics.
Xtina did much more than just write a few lyrics. By the end of 2000, she seized control of both her personal and professional life. Just 20 years old, Xtina struck Grammy Gold, found love, changed managers, took heat from the press, and hit the top of the charts. The former teen diva had truly become a woman in every sense of the word. Christina Aguilera was now poised to get down and dirty.
It's crazy. I'm everything, thrilled, overwhelmed, a little exhausted. but my energy is like on the highest level right now. I couldn't be happier.
By January 2001, 20-year-old Christina Aguilera had a new management team in place and was back in the recording studio. She joined Ricky Martin for the duet Nobody Wants to Be Lonely.
Being in a studio with her, I realized that she was a very intense woman, a very passionate woman with an incredible talent. Her voice is enchanting.
The single was released in February and shot up to number 3 on the Adult Contemporary charts. In April, Christina's longtime producer Ron Fair was handed an important assignment at his new job as president of A&M Records, a division of Interscope.
Interscope Records had made a deal with Baz Luhrmann to do the soundtrack album for Moulin Rouge. Written into the plot of the movie, there was always a use of the song Lady Marmalade. It was always considered that there would be a group of names or a group of differing divas to sing the song and like replicate LaBelle.
LaBelle, as in Patti LaBelle. Hip-hop artist Missy Elliott was brought on board to update LaBelle's 70s disco hit. Ron produced the new vocals.
He wanted to have Christina do Lady Marmalade. He knew that she had the voice to make this a huge success. So he actually assembled a great all-star group with Maya and Pink and Lil' Kim. What a feisty little group they were.
Are you gonna get crazy tonight?
I will. You heard the rumors. They're all true.
The singers each recorded their parts separately. Then in April, the five divas joined forces for the star-studded video. The song tells the body tale of Lady Marmalade, a New Orleans hooker who woos potential clients with the famous French phrase, "Voulez-vous coucher avec moi ce soir?" Translation, would you like to go to bed with me tonight? The divas came dressed to kill.
Christina made me feel very comfortable on the Marmalade song she did. At the Marmalade video, it was just so much like we were putting on a Broadway play.
She was excited to work with, yeah, all the girls. She was really excited because each one is so different and they're so varied. I think it was a great project for each one of those girls.
When you have perfectionist women working on the same set, you get very focused on what you're doing and you get very closed in a little bit on what you're doing because you don't want to mess up and make the other girls look bad.
Lady Marmalade was released in May 2001 and shot up to number 1 on the Billboard charts. The video played round the clock on MTV. The press, however, pounced on Christina once again. Critics said her Moulin Rouge hooker costume went way too far.
They had to be like, Christina, dressed like a whore. And it's like, okay, she's playing a part, she's playing a character, it's a video, it's dress up. You know, and she had the most clothes on next to Maya. Like, Pink and Little Kim's outfits were much more revealing, and Christina's the one that still got all the crap about it. It is just kind of funny how, you know, people find flaw with everything.
Still, fashion reviews were the last thing on Christina's mind. She was ready to record her next album, But this time, the ambitious singer wanted to show everyone she was more than just a pretty voice.
She came to me and she said, you know, Ron, I'm going to ask you to do something you're not good at.
I told everyone, I was like, this next record, it's got to be me. Or else I just won't make a record. You know, I have to do it my way this time.
I need your opinion, but let me drive. So I threw her the keys.
Right before she went on tour for the first record, we handed her a pile of journals. We said, don't worry about writing songs. Just write down everything.
Write it all down, you know, all the experiences, all the pain and exhaustion and the heartbreak and everything that you're going through.
I took diary entries, poem excerpts, you know, everything, you know, from what I'd written on the road. And I'd gotten so many ideas, I was just bursting to just get in the studio and get with someone that got it. And that was the next step that was going to be difficult, was finding the right people.
I made some suggestions for collaborators. Scott Storch, who has 9 songs on the record, I introduced them. And I was around to literally, you know, guide her through whenever she hit the wall.
Storch worked with Dr. Dre, Snoop Dogg, and Busta Rhymes. He was unquestionably one of the hottest hip-hop producers around.
I was anxious and curious to work with her, you know, and try and see how my music and production would sound on her, with her voice.
Christina was eager to break away from teen pop and try something new.
Exploring a little bit more with hip-hop, R&B, you know, just more mature-sounding music, which is what I listen to when I go home.
She wanted to have a lot of different dimensions. Like, she wanted some soul, like neo-soul type of urban sounding. She wanted to do a couple of rock songs.
I'm a young woman now. I have a lot to say, a lot of issues to address. You know, I want to make a real record that is relatable to people, that people can feel from the heart.
She's an incredible writer, you know? She embraced the tracks with her pen and her pad, and she wrote the verses and the hooks and everything and the meat of the songs.
Coming up, Christina's meltdown.
She threw herself on the ground and like crunched up in a ball. And she was like, what am I gonna do?
I'm doing something very creative right now. I'm getting, it's almost like therapy what I'm going through right now with my record, and I'm really getting personal with it. It'll be a very personal record.
By May 2001, Christina Aguilera was completely immersed in the making of her 4th album, Stripped. The 20-year-old pop sensation co-wrote and co-produced most of the songs. But Christina had no control over the release of a song she recorded for a demo tape called Just Be Free.
I had worked with these producers back in the day when I was, 14, 15 years old. Well, these people kept this, and when she became famous, they built music all around it.
These were scratch demo vocals, and they released it like a CD, kind of shady behind my back, you know, without kind of getting any approval from me.
Christina made them put a disclaimer on the front to let them know, look, this is when I was 15 years old. This is not the quality that I think my fans deserve.
Christina's fans knew better. By this point, the 20-year-old was a major force in the music industry.
The world's best-selling female Latin artist is Christina Aguilera.
Ah, thank you so much. Muchas gracias. Thank you so much. This is quite an honor for me. Wow, a World Music Award. Thank you so
Professionally,
much.
Christina Aguilera had everything under control, but her relentless schedule wreaked havoc on her relationship with George Santos. In September 2001, the couple called it quits.
I don't think theirs came to this. They didn't have a horrible, explosive breakup, you know, of what anybody wants to believe. It was just kind of they just grew apart and had different needs and wanted to pursue different things in their lives, and it just kind of dissipated.
She loved him and he loved her, and they still are in contact today. You know, they still remain friends.
In January 2002, Christina received her 3rd Grammy nomination, this time for the remake of Lady Marmalade. In February, Christina, Lil' Kim, Pink, Maya, and Missy Elliott were invited to sing their hit song live at the awards ceremony. Only the second time they performed the song together.
I think adrenaline
was so up there that we were all like nervous, not nervous in the sense of, oh, shaking, but nervous like, yo, we just want to put on the best show that we can ever put on.
The night became truly electric when the girls were joined on stage by the Queen Diva herself, Patti LaBelle, who originally recorded Lady Marmalade in 1974.
People went crazy, you know, they leapt to their feet. It was just one of those moments when you're like, wow, this is history.
After we performed the song, I sat right behind, my seat was right behind Celine Dion. And she turned to me and she tapped me on my shoulder and was like, oh, it was great. She's like, oh, that performance was great. And I was like, thank you, you know, this is Celine Dion.
The girls left the Grammys that night with more than just thunderous applause ringing in their ears.
The Grammy will go to
Lady Marmalade.
Oh my gosh, this was so unexpected. Thank you.
On the outside, Christina seemed to be on top of the world. But those close to her saw a very different reality. In the summer of 2002, Christina reeled from the news that she'd been betrayed by people she once trusted.
One of them threatened to write a tell-all book, and the other, there was a financial dispute.
And these are the people that were my shoulder to cry on while I was going through this with someone else, you know?
She was so devastated, she actually ran down the street out of her house in complete frustration and desperation, and she threw herself on the ground and like crunched up in a ball, and she was like, what am I gonna do? What am I gonna do? It was the closest she had ever come to having a nervous breakdown.
When times were tough, Christina always turned to her music, and this was no exception. Each song became deeply personal.
An incredible amount of pressure, I think, was put on her because, you know, in the past, the songs were there and ready. She just had to show up and sing and put her flavor on the records. Whereas this time, you know, she was responsible for the ship, you know what I mean? Like, if the ship goes down, it's on her.
She's like my protege. She's every bit the perfectionist that I am and maybe more. So she would never tolerate any singing that was less than exactly what she had in mind.
She wanted to be real clear about what she was writing and have the songs really be what she wanted to say.
By the fall of 2002, Christina Aguilera completed the long-awaited follow-up to her debut album. Strip took a year and a half to make, three times as long as her first CD. Christina insisted the opening song make a bold statement.
She wanted to come on the scene with a pow, something like jarring, shocking, and incredible, and hard.
I wanted something that could be played in, you know, the young, you know, kind of club scene that would just kind of but explode in your face.
A song that was hard and could be banged in the clubs, that would resonate with the street and work at rhythm radio and pop radio.
So Dirty was my choice for first single because it had that explosion.
The Dirty video needed to match the musical intensity of the song. So Christina turned to photographer David LaChapelle, who directed Mariah Carey's video, Loverboy.
Christina and David kind of sat down and came up with the concept that they wanted.
The theme was extreme, very extreme.
It was just like a party on set. It was the funnest video I've ever done.
And very down and dirty.
She loved getting in and boxing and, you know, getting dirty physically, you know, being greased up and dirty. Dirty was more of a not being prissy, not being pretty, being gritty, dirty, not being afraid to get out there and have some fun.
Then in October 2002, the gossip hounds smelled blood when they spotted Christina with former Mouseketeer pal Justin Timberlake.
It's so funny when I read these articles that she's linked with this person and that person, but Justin's a cool guy in particular, you know. We got a chance to hang out last time. We were both in London around the same time, and he's always fun. He's a fun kid, but nothing romantic at all.
Yeah. We're not dating. We are not dating.
We
bicker like brother and sister.
Why you gotta say bicker?
Because
we don't bicker.
It's a great
word. Well, maybe
it's
bicker.
Bicker. It's just fun to say.
Bicker means like argue, though.
Look.
Okay. Okay.
Later that October, Dirty debuted with a bang.
When the video came out, it was a big shocker. You know, the chaps and the whole thing. But it's like, that is me being a 22-year-old female, being free of my inhibitions.
It was meant to be dirty. She was very sexy in it, and she was soaking wet. And she was dancing really provocatively, and the lyrics are provocative.
She looks good in the video, and the video's tight. A little Fight Club thing.
It's different than what you saw on MTV or whatever, you know, and it was just, it's just a video, you know, and it was so much fun.
Critics slammed the video, but that wasn't all. The words Thailand sex tourism and young underage girls in Thai could be read in the background. The Thai government threatened to take legal action.
Of course, it was shocking to some people or whatever, the change, but did you not notice Lady Marmalade, you know, that step forward? Did you not notice that now I'm 22 years old, you know, from 17? It's quite a difference.
The firestorm of negative publicity overshadowed the quality of the song. Although Dirty climbed up to 48 on the charts, it was a disappointing release.
Let me tell you, the song worked everywhere but America. Here, what happened is they pulled the plug on it too quick, and because people got scared of the image.
Go to England, they love it. Go to Germany, go to Italy. This was a huge, huge song. I think that Americans couldn't, they didn't know what to do with it because of the video.
Whether you loved it, whether you hate it, whatever you said about it, it got your attention.
By anyone's standards, Dirty was dirty, and the perfect vehicle to be lampooned on Saturday Night Live. On October 12, 2002, Sarah Michelle Gellar hosted the show and took an outrageous turn as Christina Aguilera.
When you get to a point that Saturday Night Live is parodying you, well, then you've made quite a statement.
I just feel so free now, you know, because when people see this video, they're going to stop thinking of me as some blonde-haired, bubblegum music industry hoe.
She's someone who's silly, so she kind of gets humor when we heard they were doing this spoof. So we got really excited and we watched it.
Christina's really funny about it. She was like, I could have done a better job making fun of myself than Sarah Michelle Gellar did.
It just ain't skanky enough, you know? I ain't feeling it.
Sorry, let La Chapelle think. Think, La Chapelle. You are you. What do you think?
I think everything that happens to you that may be seen at the time in a negative light, it always motivates you. It's always driven me to do better.
On October 29th, 2002, Strip was finally released. For Christina, the album was an intimate self-portrait.
That's why it's called Strip. I wanted kind of a one-word, get right to the point. It was being emotionally stripped down to the real me, who I really am.
She wrote a song that's on Strip called I'm Okay, and it says, bruises fade, father, but the pain remains the same. And it was her way of saying, I'm still dealing with this.
I was going to do it as a hidden track, but I decided to bring it out in the forefront. The rest of the album has deeper lyrical content and gets down to the nitty-gritty of kind of my vulnerability, my past issues, what I feel about life and female empowerment, and always being a girl's girl and wanting to stick up for that.
And my girl's right here. Thank you guys so much for making it great. Yes.
She wanted to show us, like, I'm growing up and I have this dirty down, dirty, raunchy style. Whether you're gonna have to take it or leave it, you know? And it's not that I'm abandoning my popish style. I want to give you a combination, and I want to be able to do it all.
Strip debuted on the charts at number 2, but dropped to number 4 the next week.
It wasn't the instant success that people had probably expected it to be, and I think that's because the single, Dirty, was not as strong as Genie Man Bottle was to lead off an album. It still performed really respectably, but it was not a huge number one right out of the bag.
Thank you so much. So happy to be here.
In just 6 years, 22-year-old Christina Aguilera transformed herself from pop princess to dirty diva. Whether she wore outrageous clothes or nothing at all, Aguilera kept audiences on their toes and coming back for more.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
In May 2003, Maxim magazine announced their annual pick for the hottest woman of the year. The winner, Christina Aguilera. Later that month, Christina heated things up even more when she started rehearsals for a North American tour with her former Mickey Mouse Club co-star, Justin Timberlake.
It's a co-headlining tour, so our shows are separate. So it's not like we're, you know, together during the show.
Her manager brought the idea to her as around the same time my manager brought the idea to me, and we both said, you know, it sounds like fun. It sounds like an innovative way to do a show, especially for the audience, you know, to come and see a show where you get to see two completely, you know, different people.
It's just an exciting feeling to be able to, you know, team up with somebody you've known for years and do what you kind of always dreamt about back then, and doing it together now.
The Justified Strip Combo Tour kicked off in June 2003 at Phoenix, Arizona. Next stop, Oakland, California. Christina was ready to rock.
Now I'm in the outfit that I'm going to be doing my first number of the show in, and open it up with a bang and getting the audience kind of hyped and crazy.
Life on tour was deja vu for the two former Mouseketeers.
A decade ago, we were, you know, doing a television show together. Now, being young adults and seeing where we're both at, and I mean, it's just fun. You know, we both love what we do, so that's what makes this tour so fun for us.
And I'm so happy that I get to be up here this time around doing my own material, so I'm very happy about that. And honestly though, thank you so much for having grown with me. Me being 22 years old now, you know, I'm a different person, I've grown up.
It's such a blessing to be able to do my material. It's a totally different feeling, and hearing them, it's actually interesting because they sing along with this new album more than they do the old, which was kind of a surprise for me. When they walk away from this show and you see me perform, you know, these lyrics and these issues that I feel strongly about, you're going to see the passion that comes with that. And it's just great to be able to really express them all with an audience who you're connecting with.
The young star always wanted to convey a message of female empowerment. In July 2003, Christina did just that with the release of her song and video, Can't Hold Us Down.
The song's about the double standard and what is fair and what's not fair and how society looks at men and what's acceptable by men and how society objectifies women.
Rapper Lil' Kim added her voice to the mix.
It was a very women empowering song. Right up my alley. Can't Hold Us Down is a great example of Stripped, of what she wanted to put out there with this album.
The shy girl who used music to escape her troubled childhood has grown into an innovative artist whose extraordinary voice inspires millions of fans the world over.
She's been beaten and stabbed and stolen from and hurt and hurt and hurt and hurt. And yet, you know, my girl has risen above it. And she's strong and she's determined to help others to be the same way.
Yeah, I'm proud of her. I'm glad that she's now in the shoes that she's in and that she's worked her way to get here.
I intend on being here for a while, and I'm always going to be pushing the limits and breaking new boundaries.
Thank you. Thank you so much.